Good morning. We will let everyone bring their chatter inside this morning. I love that you guys are fellowshipping and enjoying each other's company. Are you thankful that we serve a risen Savior?
Amen.
I think it kind of cracks me up. Because people get really excited at Easter time that Jesus is risen. But guess what, guys? He's risen last Sunday, too. He's alive, guys. Last week, he was, too. I love that we serve it. I mean, that we, acknowledge it, once a year or whatever, like Christmas. But I just think that it just kind of tickles me a little bit that we get so excited about it once a year. So let's carry this excitement with us the rest of the year because Jesus is alive. He is with us always. And so let's stand this morning. We're going to get some of our, in kids' church, I call it getting our wiggles out. Okay, we get real. Yes, wiggles. I said wiggles. I did. See, they know what to do. They just start kind of getting their wiggles out. So if you need to get your wiggles out this morning to loosen up so we can worship. There's not a lot of announcements this morning, so I'm just going to touch on a couple. I want to say thank you to the ones who came and served yesterday for our annual Easter egg hunt. It went great. Kids loved it. Adults loved it. So thank you. Whether you purchased some candy to help us in that area or you came and you helped kind of spread the eggs out, thank you for that. And also, there are a couple announcements. If you would just grab your bulletin and look over those this morning, that would really help us out and we can go right into worshiping this morning. Okay. We are ready. Are you guys ready?
Hallelujah.
And gone, gone, sin is gone and he is risen. What a Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
this morning. Thank you for who you are, God. We worship you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Maybe it's a friend. I don't know. You do. But let's take these needs to the Lord, and let's ask our prayer team if they would pray with us. I told Tracy Langdon this morning we would specifically mention her in prayer. She is having some complications after her amputation, and so she just needs God's touch this morning. And so if you... especially if I could have two or three in the crowd, just go before the Lord this morning on her behalf. But if you have any other needs this morning, it is your time. You get to share them with a prayer team member, and they will pray with you over that. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you for who you are, and we thank you that your grace is enough, that your mercy is new every morning. Thank you that we can come before you boldly. We can ask for your help. We can ask for your grace. We can ask for your forgiveness, Lord. Lord, whatever needs are represented in this building are for the ones watching online today. God, I pray that you would meet the need. Lord, that you would break every chain that is in this service, that you would break the bondage that is here this morning. God, you came to give life. So God, I speak that over this congregation this morning. Lord, for the needs that are up on the screen and for the ones that, Lord, no one has shared yet. You see our hearts, Lord. Help us to bring them to you with open hands, saying, God, here is the need. I am not in control. You are, Lord. Your will be done, Jesus. And we say thank you in advance because we know that you hear us and that you will meet the needs, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, and rolls to white.
Thank you, Jesus.
The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise above the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Hallelujah. Can you worship him this morning?
You are good, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God, you are worthy, Father. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord, our God. Oh, praise. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise him. God, we worship you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. You are worthy, God. You are worthy, Father. We magnify you. We worship you, Father. We adore you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give him a hand clap of praise this morning. Thank you, worship team. Amen. Amen. Our kids will be in here with us this morning. Thank you, Andrew. Hey, can you do me another favor? Amen. Thank you, buddy. Amen. Nursery is available, so be mindful of that. Amen. You glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Amen. On this Resurrection Sunday. So thankful that he rose again. Amen?
Amen?
So thankful. Amen. This morning, before we jump into the word, we're going to, we got a special treat. It is so good to have Charles's family, with us this morning. And we're going to have his brother come and share. His brother is a pastor in California. And they have actually are just launching a ministry down in Texas. They're headed to God's country down in Texas to launch a ministry. And Robert, you share with us what God is leading you guys into.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Justin.
He's got the red mic, Simone.
Good morning, Tribune.
Good morning.
Man, it's awesome to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Oh, sorry. I preach out of a garage, so I usually don't get a mic. I usually have to be really loud, so and then my ears clogged this morning, but that's okay. I was sharing with Pastor Justin what the Lord's put on our heart. I've been pastoring for 12 years. My wife's been a teacher for 24 years. And who knows that the prophets were saying that 2020 was going to be the year of vision, right? Like 2020 vision, right? And man, I think a lot of prophets got wrecked. but But what happened to us was it really did become a year of vision for us. The scales kind of fell off of our eyes, and through a lot of prayer and just battling with depression, battling with anxiety, you know, through our family. We're in California, and so my wife, being a teacher for 24 years and being separated from her kids, her school kids, and being stuck at home for, it's been over a year now, she started dealing with anxiety, started dealing with depression, and so, you know, we've been on our knees, been praying, been seeking the Lord, and then my son starts going through it, and we're praying and seeking the Lord, and that whole time, the Lord, we watched this documentary, and it was about human trafficking, and man, the scales fell off my eyes, and really the vision just hit us, you know, my wife's eyes, and what the Lord was showing us was we got to get involved. We got to get doing something as a church, as a people, as a person. And I knew in my heart, if I didn't do anything, I'd be grieving the Holy Spirit. And who here today knows you don't want to be grieving the Holy Spirit? Like, that's the worst place you could be. And I know Pastor Justin told me how to keep it short. So I started praying, Lord, son, stand still, you know. So I'm just kidding. I will give you the mic back. But there's this quote that hit. And the quote says, as a body, our job is to transform darkness into light. But that transformation only happens if we dare to look into the darkness. And so, man, when we dared to look into the darkness, it was tragic, just overwhelming. You know, when you see the statistics of, you know, 40 million stuck in human trafficking, 20 million of them in forced labor, 5 million of them in sex trafficking, and then I think another, there's quite a bit more in forced marriages, man, you know what the Lord was speaking to me was that these aren't statistics, you know. These are my sons and my daughters that are stuck in this. You know, every wicked thing that you could ever imagine happening to them. And, there's the statistics right there. When I seen that, you know, and it's not that I didn't know about human trafficking. Like, in 2012, I really started hearing about it a lot. And back then, it was 23 million stuck in human trafficking, and here 2021 it's 40 million. These are just estimates. There's no, you know, final number. There's no, it's just estimates, you know. And I know in America it's like they know of 199,000 cases. You know, last year I think it was like 53,000 cases that were just reported. And so when that burden just started hitting my heart hard. And so what we did was we prayed, and I asked my wife, I said, you know, would you sell our house? Would you sell our house so we could go and start a ministry? And she said, yeah, whatever the Lord's asking us to do. And I said, okay, so the Lord put it on our house. He gave us, like, specific dates on when to sell the house. So we sold our house, and then, like, the next day after signing the paperwork on our house being sold, we actually went in contract to buy a house in Texas and start a ranch. I guess you would call it, it's not a ranch to you guys. It's like 6 acres. I know you guys are messing around with 20,000 acres here. To me, it's a ranch. Like, we live on, like, just this, you know, you see California houses. They're all jammed in together. I see 6 acres, and I'm like, wow, that's a lot to mow. I'm not sure. I guess I'm going to have to get goats as part of the ranch or something. So then he hit me with this scripture in Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58, verse 6. Let me get there. I did bookmark it. And I think, yep, there it is. And the scripture is not this the fast that I have chosen you, to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke? And that's what he's called us to. That's the mandate. That's the mission that he's put on our heart. And so Pastor Justin was asking, you know, it's amazing. Like really, this is God's country. Like in California, when you tell somebody like that, think, oh, that's awesome. That's amazing. And then that's about the end of it, you know. But here, you know, I guess my brother started spreading the, you know, you guys all know Charles. He's going to spread the word. And so when he shared with Pastor Justin, and then, you know, we sat down together yesterday, and you guys got an amazing pastor, let me tell you, because his thing was, how can we help? And if you guys are a part of a church like that, you guys are serving in an amazing church, you know. And so I just said, give me some exposure. Give me some time. And he graciously let me have the mic, and I promise I'm about to give it back. So that's what we've been called to do. My dad and my mom, they're going to be part of the ministry out there. Me and my wife and my kids are going to be out there. And we're just going to start a healing ranch coming in 2022. This is the ranch. That's our heart, is we just want to help. Just like whatever the Lord calls us to do, that's what we're going to do. You know, and these are God's children that are sons and daughters that are stuck in this. And it's, you know, it's a rampant thing. It's a thing that's just running out of control. And one other thing that was really eye-opening is it's actually an end-time prophecy. If you go and you look in Joel 3:3, God says that he's going to sit in judgment of the nations for selling his children. You know, and so what he told me is we have to do something as a church. You know, there has to be something. And don't get me wrong, there are churches that are already doing amazing work, that are already involved. I'm probably late showing up to the show, but we're going to do something. I have to do something. And so that's my heart. That's our ministry. And I'm glad you guys, thank you, Pastor Justin, for giving me this time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Robert. Amen. As he said, there are ministries that are, don't go anywhere. You guys stay up here close. There are ministries that specialize in this, hold on, buddy. God has called them to minister to the brokenhearted, to help, to heal that which is broken. If you know anything about the sex trafficking industry, it's full of broken people. And there are ministries that we support that a portion of what they do is related to that. And then they're growing up in Texas. I know of some ministries that are doing it, but they're doing something that is specific to them. More of a we talked about it yesterday. Their vision is more of a day camp and something that is not just a 1 week incident or 1 week event, but something that people can come to over and over again until the healing is done, the healing is complete, and so God has called them to a tremendous ministry with a field of broken people. Broken people that need to be made whole again. And the beautiful thing of it is God doesn't waste any of it. It's not his intention for people to go through that pain and to go through those things, but he's not going to waste any of it. And so this morning, church, we are actually, if I'm not mistaken, the very first outside of his own church there. We're the very first church that they've spoken at. And so this is kind of the launch for them. And so, Robert, if you would, bring your family up. And if I could have some folks, let's gather around them. Charles, Nicole, come on up here, buddy. Let's have some folks gather around these, some men and some women, if you would, please. We're going to pray over them and anoint them and pray that God blesses. It's in the very beginning stages. It's in the very beginning stages. And so I know... I didn't give them a whole lot of time because we got a lot of things to get to this morning. But I know he's got a passion on his heart. She's got a passion on her heart. And so if God speaks to your heart and you want to support them in ministry, please talk with them after service. But there's a lot more to the story than he was able to share in the 5 minutes that this guy up here gave him. But there's a lot more to the story. And so if you would, visit with them after service and talk with them about it. Amen. Jay, if you would, lead us in prayer over this family. Hallelujah. God, we thank you for this family, for the calling that you've placed upon their life. God, I pray, Lord, that you would go before them as you already have, that you would clear out any barriers that may be in their way. Father, I pray that you would put them in connection with the right people. Father, that would help clear any red tape or anything. Father, help them to get the training that they need. Put them in contact with people that they need to be in contact with. Father, so that your work can grow quickly and be fruitful quickly. God, I pray, Lord, that you would just bless them, that you would minister to them, meet every need that they may have, Father, so that sons and daughters can come into relationship with you out of brokenness and out of destruction. God, we worship you. We thank you. In your precious name we pray. Everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. Blessings upon you. Amen. Amen. God is still calling, amen? Thank you, Robert, for sharing what God is calling y'all to do, what he's calling you into. To those who are being sex trafficked and there's going to be healing that takes place because of this. And so thank you for sharing what is on your heart, amen? Church, take time after service, visit with them, talk with them, please. And if you'd like to support them, amen, allow God to minister and talk to your heart and talk with them about that. Amen. Amen. Let's stand this morning. You're going to get our calisthenics in. Turn to somebody and say, he ain't dead. Turn to the other side. Turn to the person on the other side. He ain't dead. Amen. When you're done, you may be seated. Amen. Amen. Be mindful this morning, church, after service, after the message is done and altar service is done, we will be partaking of communion. So be mindful of that. That'll be at the end of the message and at the end of altar service this morning. Amen. Does anybody enjoy sports? I enjoy sports. I enjoy sports. Mainly college sports. I really enjoy college sports. There's a basketball tournament going on right now. It's March Madness, and the ladies tournament is going on, and the men's tournament. Ladies championship is today. The boys national championship is tomorrow night, and it's just a blast to watch. You know, they're not getting paid. You know, legally they're not getting paid. But they're playing for the love of the game, or actually they're playing so that one day that they can get paid, a lot of them. But it's a blast to watch because there's all-out effort. They go at it, and so I love it. There's nervous energy when close games happen, and it's just awesome to watch. Baseball's just recently started, and that's all we'll say about that because my team is not very good, but I enjoy watching some baseball. But I enjoy sports, and mostly what people enjoy about sports is the end of the game, especially when it's a close game. People love the end of a close game. I mean, when it comes down to the last shot, the final shot, or in a baseball game, when it comes down to the final pitch, the final at bat, there's and it's close, man. There's a lot on the line with that shot, or with that at bat, or with that next pitch. And just last night, I wasn't able to see it, But Gonzaga and UCLA were playing, and UCLA was the underdog. UCLA is 11 seed. They're playing the number one seed in all of the nation, Gonzaga. And it came down to the wire. UCLA hits a shot, and they tie it up 90-90. And Gonzaga gets the ball out of bounds real quick. They inbound it, and there's a freshman guard. He's dribbling it down the court, and he pulls up just 2 or 3 feet past half court, and there was only 3.3 seconds left. He pulls up 3 or 4 feet just past half court and shoots it, and of course, there's not a whole lot of people in the stadium, but a hush falls over the stadium. And then bang! It hits the backboard and goes in. A three-point shot. Three-point bank shot. And if you know anything about basketball, you're supposed to call, bank is open. I don't know if he did, but the shot counted. Gonzaga won. The number one seed in all of the nation moves on to the national championship tomorrow night against Baylor. You guessed it, a Texas team. They're blessed by God. They may win it. We don't know. But it was awesome. Even just watching the replay of it was awesome. The energy that was there, the excitement that was there, and it was exciting. Unless you're a UCLA fan, it was very exciting. We love and we enjoy exciting finishes. Maybe this morning you're not a sports fan. You don't like sports. Maybe you're more of the person that you like touching movies. Romanticals. You like romanticals. That's what I've started calling them. My wife likes these Lifetime or these Hallmark movies. She doesn't get to watch a whole lot of them, thank the Lord. Because of the family that we have and the amount of boys that we have. And I love the Lord more and more every day because of that. But there's a problem with these movies, okay? There is. The problem with these movies is they're all the same movie. They are. Don't shake your head. They are. They really are, okay? They're the same movie. They're just played by different actors in different clothes in a different setting. But I can tell you how every movie starts and how every movie ends, okay? You ready? I'm going to, in two paragraphs, I'm going to solve every Hallmark movie for you, okay? This is the movie. There's a small town girl. Am I right so far? Yes, I am. Thank you. She moves to the big city to make something out of herself. Yeah? Because the small town's not, I mean, it's not big enough. Okay? Then she has to return home for one reason or the other. Typically, it's a family reunion, or she lost her job, or there's a high school reunion happening, and she's going to go back, and she's going to let everybody see how big she's gotten. And so she has to return home to the small town to prove that she's made something out of herself. But here's the caveat, is typically she's either just gotten engaged or she's just broke up with her fiancé. Okay? It's one of those two things. She just got engaged or she just broke up with her fiancé, her very successful fiancé, okay? He's a lawyer or, you know, he's the mayor or something that lives in the big city. And while at home, whether she's engaged or not engaged, she meets her high school sweetheart all over again and gets reacquainted with them all over again. Typically, they bump into each other in a coffee shop. In Colorado. They're all set, most of them, in Colorado. So she gets reacquainted with the love of her life, and the movie goes through all this other junk, but it ends with them getting married. That is the movie in two paragraphs. You don't have to watch them anymore. That's how it goes. Thank you. That's how they all finish. And regardless of the movie, my wife cries at some point in time in the movie. And it's ridiculous. She gets mad when I don't watch it with her, and I say, these things are stupid, and they're a waste of my time. You're probably correct, Miss Barbara. You are probably correct. Let's move on. I like it when a job is done, right? Everybody like it when a job is done? When I ran my construction company back in and around the St. Louis area, I had two favorite days. That was the start day, which was demo day, typically. And then the day that we finished. And we was able to walk off the project with it all done. There's a sense of accomplishment that comes from finishing something that you started. And being able to look and see what you've done. And this morning, we're going to talk about finishing. And actually, we're going to talk about the best finisher that there's ever been in our promise today. If you haven't been with us, we've been going through the different promises in the Word of God, promises from God to man. And so we've been walking through that throughout this year so far. And in my opinion, it's been a very encouraging, a very uplifting series. It's also been a very challenging series. Because there's conditions to a lot of the promises that God has for us. And so today's promise is found in Philippians. Philippians chapter 1 is where we're going to be at. But before we read through it this morning, we're going to set the stage like we typically do, okay? Paul's in prison when he writes the book of Philippians. He's in prison because he's preached the gospel, and he's traveled thousands upon thousands of miles. He's literally planted dozens of churches and ministries, and he's led hundreds of people into relationship with Christ. And he has preached, ever since his conversion, he's preached the wonderful, powerful message of the gospel of Christ. But now, after all that he's done, everything that he's been through, I mean, he's been shipwrecked, he's been stoned, he's been beaten, he's been imprisoned, and after everything that he's done for Christ and for the kingdom of Christ, Paul finds himself not just in any ordinary prison, but he finds himself in a Roman prison chained to a Roman soldier. And if you're on the outside looking in on Paul's situation, if you know anything about that culture and about history of that time, it's over for Paul. I mean, now that he's in a Roman jail and he's chained to a Roman prisoner or a Roman guard, his situation is over. It's done with. So it looks bleak. And so after giving his life and living his life for Christ, his reward now is a prison, a trial, and death. And more than likely, death in the arena where the Romans would humiliate their prisoners. It looked bleak. The thing of it is, the church that he's writing to, the church of Philippi, yeah, that one too, the Philippian church, they're going through their own difficulties. They're going through their own hard time. And Paul is writing this letter to them, but they're in as much trouble as Paul's in because they're being intimidated and persecuted from outside forces and from outside sources. And then on the inside the church people are fighting and arguing and things don't look good. I mean, the church is about done. It's about to close its doors. It's about to just close down. And so Paul, he finds himself in an impossible, hopeless situation, and the Philippian church find themselves in trouble as well. And Paul writes this letter, and in spite of all the trouble that he's in, Paul starts his letter this way, and I want you to listen, and I want you to read if you have it available. We're going to start our reading in verse 3. Paul says this, "I thank my God." Remember, he's in prison. His death is around the corner, coming down the road sometime, and he says, "I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, for you all, making my prayer with joy." So that means he was praying, and he was praying for them, and because he was praying for them, it brought him joy. Because of your partnership in the gospel from this day until now. So Paul starts out this letter to the church of Philippians, to the church of Philippi, with these words. These encouraging words. He says, "I thank God. I thank God. And I remember you. And when I pray for you, and when I remember you, you bring me joy." In spite of the situation that he's in, being chained to a Roman soldier in prison, Paul looks past his present situation. past his circumstances, and he remembers them, the church of Philippi, and he prays for them, and it brings him joy. And the thing of it is Paul wants the church of Philippi, he wants them to look past what they're going through, their present conflicts and situations and arguments as well. He wants them to look past it as well. And Paul, the thing of it is Paul could have joy in the situation he was in because he understood. He understood the promise that we're about to get to. He understood the promise, and he wants them to understand the promise as well. And he tells them in the promise, and we're going to find it in verse 6, he tells them this. He says, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." What's he saying? What's he saying? What's he telling the church of Philippi there? He's telling he says, what God has started, he will finish. What God has started, he will finish. Paul's in a prison. Paul's in prison yet again. He's been through so many difficulties, and so how does Paul gain this perspective of what God started, he's going to finish? How does he gain this wonderful perspective? Well, honestly, this morning, if we were to continue to read through the book of Philippians, we would find out. And in chapter 3, if you want to flip on over there, Philippians chapter 3, work your way down to verses 10 and 11, he tells them, and Paul says this, he says, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, become like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. That I may know him in the power of his resurrection, and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead." Paul understood. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 10 and 11, he understood that it's not over. It's not. This isn't where it ends. This isn't the last stop, because Paul knew about the cross. Paul knew about the cross, and Paul knew about the resurrection, and he knew about the risen Savior. And so, in essence, Paul knew about Easter. He knew about Easter, and in Jesus' 3 years of ministry, here on earth, he walked throughout all of Israel, and he taught, and he taught a lot of new things. He taught that there was a new way to live. There was a new way to live, and he also did a lot of things that people hadn't seen of or heard of, and he healed people. And then he began to challenge the religious authorities and those who weren't living right. And what he did is he gave hope to the hopeless. He gave hope to the hopeless, and he inspired belief and people. He inspired belief in people that God was doing something fresh, and he was doing something new. That it wasn't just the same old, same old. It wasn't just the same old tradition and ritual, but God was doing something fresh and new. And in his ministry on earth, Jesus attracted people from all walks of life. It didn't matter if they were rich or poor. It didn't matter if they were young or old. He attracted people. He was popular, and there were massive amounts of people that began to follow Christ. They rejected the religious systems of that day and time, and they began to follow him. And that made the religious people of that day and time irate with him. That made it very angry with him. And it also ticked off a bunch of political leaders as well. And it reached a boiling point. It reached a boiling point with these leaders. And they finally captured him. They took him captive. And they couldn't find anything on him that was true. And so what they did is they drummed up charges against him. They falsely accused him of things that he didn't do in order to stir up the crowd against him. And they knew the buttons to push. They knew exactly which buttons to push. And they beat him, they mocked him, and ultimately they crucified him. They crucified him. And at that moment of crucifixion and death, if we were looking through our human eyes and through our human perspective, we'd say it's over. It's over. This guy, this man, this Messiah, he had all these grandiose plans. He was a great teacher, and he had all these promises, and everything that he said appeared to be stopped by the evil leaders of that day and time. And if you read through the scriptures, even his closest followers had their doubts. And if we were to put ourselves in their shoes this morning, we would also have our doubts. Man, this guy started strong, but man, he didn't do everything that he said. He really dropped the ball there at the end. He said he was the Messiah, and he did a lot of really neat stuff, but now he's dead. Now he's dead. Everything that he promised, everything that he said, it was all a lie. It's not true. We were hopeful that he was going to lead us out of bondage. We were hopeful that he was going to lead us to be a great nation. It's too bad that he couldn't finish everything that he said he would do. It's too bad that he couldn't do what he said he would do. And this morning, maybe you have your own doubts about God. Maybe you have your own doubts about who Christ is. And you've tried. You feel this morning, you feel like you've gave it all. You've tried everything, but it just didn't turn out the way you thought it would. It didn't turn out the way that it should have. Retirement was supposed to be great, but things aren't going well. Maybe your health is failing, or your spouse's health is failing, or you're going through something that you never thought you would go through in retirement. College was going awesome, and man, you've partied and you've lived it up, but now you didn't study enough. Now you're in danger of losing your scholarships or your financing. Maybe you're a parent this morning and you taught your kids all the right ways. You taught them how to worship. You taught them how to read their Bible and to pray, but now they're far away from God, and you feel like a parenting failure. Maybe it's your marriage. Your marriage started off great, but now it's in danger of ending, or it already has ended. Maybe you used to have a best friend. Now that relationship is broken. You don't even talk to each other anymore. Or maybe you've been clean, but something happened and now you've fallen back and you've relapsed. Maybe you've gotten the wonderful news that you're pregnant and then you found out that you miscarried and now you're worried about ever having kids again. Or maybe this morning you came to the United States as an immigrant and you've been trying to become a citizen. Now you're 10, 15, 20 years into this process and you're thousands upon thousands of dollars into it and it just doesn't seem like the end is in sight. Or maybe you tried some venture, starting a business and you sunk a lot of money into something and then coronavirus hit and now bankruptcy is looming. You've lost it. You've lost hope. You've given up. You've given up hope. Anybody remember the last words that Jesus spoke on the cross? It is finished. It is finished. A life with so much promise, a life with so much potential, snuffed out. Snuffed out. It was over. That's the way it looks from human eyes, right? That's the way it looks with a human perspective. But God says something totally different. He says, because what I start, I will finish. What I start, I will finish. After Christ's death, it wasn't easy for his followers. And most of them ran away and hid. And we don't know everything that all of them did, but we do know what Peter did. We do know what Peter did. Peter, he followed close. He followed Jesus until they took him in to try him, and he was close to Jesus, and so he tried to stay close to Jesus. And honestly, throughout Peter's life, the 3 years of ministry, he had walked with the Messiah. He had seen everything that had happened, demons cast out, the lame made to walk again, the mute made to talk again, the deaf made to hear again. He had seen all these things. He had seen the dead come back to life. He had seen all these things take place. And in the garden when Christ was arrested, Peter tried to be loyal. He was loyal. And so because he was loyal, he tried to protect Jesus. But if you read your Bible very much, you know a little bit later on, things changed for Peter. Things changed for Peter. Because the Bible tells us that Peter denied Christ. He denies ever knowing him. He denies ever being a follower. He curses. And, he lets everybody know, I don't know that guy. I don't want to know that man. I didn't have anything to do with him. But if you also read your Bible, you also know that's not where it ends for Peter. That's not where that's not where it finishes for him. Because when life left Christ's body there on the cross, they took him off the cross, they buried his body, and they rolled this huge stone over the opening of the grave, right? Over the entrance of the grave. That was on Friday, according to tradition, right? We won't go into any of that. Ain't got time. But the sun came up on Sunday morning in more ways than one. The sun came up on Sunday morning. The stone was rolled away from the opening of the grave. And Jesus Christ walked out. He had risen from the dead because the grave couldn't hold him. And death was not a word in his vocabulary. Amen? So it looked bad on Friday, but just a few days later, it became abundantly clear that God's plan was far from being over. Because what he starts, he finishes. What he starts, he finishes. And I want us to look at something together this morning. I want us to read through it. It's in Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16, verses 6 and 7. And I'm trying to hurry. Mark chapter 16, verses 6 and 7. And the Word of God says, "And he said to them, 'Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go and tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you.'" The angel's talking to these ladies. He says, "Hey, come see where they laid him. He's not here anymore. He's risen. Go tell his disciples." But then he says something else. And he singles a person out. He says, "And tell Peter." He had 12 followers. He had 12 disciples. Right? Why did he need to single Peter out? Why was it necessary to single Peter out of all the 12 disciples? I believe he was trying to send Peter a message. Peter needed to know it's not done. It's not finished. God wasn't done with him yet. And so what he started in Peter, he was going to complete. And if we continue to read, Peter and Jesus, they have this beautiful reunion. And soon after, Peter begins to play a vital role, a vitally important role in starting the early church and in sharing the gospel throughout the whole world. And the day came in Peter's life where his life was taken. Because he refused to deny Jesus. He refused to deny Jesus. What had been a failure early on in Peter's life turned to be out of strength in the end. Peter finished well. Peter finished well. This morning, maybe you grew up in church. You know the songs. You know the scriptures. You know Christ. You know, maybe you've had a relationship with him at one point in time. You know everything that there is to know about him. But something happened along the way. You walked away from him. Maybe this morning you're here or you're watching online and you feel like you've made too many mistakes and God will not accept you. He doesn't love you. He doesn't desire you anymore. I got a message for you. You know what the Easter message really is? The Easter message is this: it's not over. It's not over. What God started in you, church, this morning, he wants to finish. So maybe you're stuck this morning. Maybe you're stuck in a rut and you want to break through, but there's something that's holding you back. What God starts, he finishes. Maybe you're trapped in addiction or in a seemingly endless cycle of sin. What he starts, he finishes. What he starts, he finishes. There's freedom available for you this morning, and it's not because of some program, not because of some 12-step program or whatever it may be, but it's because he has a plan for you, and what he starts, he will finish. One day when you and I stand before God, and on that day, when we stand before him, all earthly success or failure isn't going to matter. No amount of money that you made or lost is going to matter. No amount of prestige that you had or lost is going to matter. None of it will matter. The only thing that will matter is that you and I finished. That we finished. We ran the race and we finished. What God starts, He will finish. What God starts, He will finish. Later in Paul's life, he writes these words found in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved His appearing. I have fought the fight. I have finished the race. So here's our challenge this morning, church. Here's our challenge. Finish what you've started. Finish what you've started. Like I said earlier, maybe you used to follow Him, but along the way you've lost your faith and now you feel trapped. You want to follow Him, but you feel like it's over. He still has a plan for you. It's not over. What He starts, He will finish. He's not done with you. Today, this morning, church, could be the new beginning that you need. It could be the new beginning. He wants to finish what He started in you. Amen? He wants to finish what He began in you. He wants you to be forgiven. He wants you to be made whole. So this morning, run back to Him. Because He will set you free. He will set you free. We celebrate Easter. We celebrate today, not because of how Christ came, but because of how He finished. How He finished. Our prayer team's coming, making themselves available. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Maybe this morning you've never had a relationship with Christ. Maybe you don't even know what all of this means that we're talking about. But you like the fact, you like the sound that He has a plan for you. A plan that isn't just about something now, but also includes a plan for the future and ultimately ends in eternal life with Him in heaven. Maybe you're here this morning, you're not sure what it takes to be a Christian. Maybe you don't even know what a Christian is. Here's the beautiful news about that. You don't have to know what it takes. And you don't even have to know what it is. Because it's not about what you do or what you don't know or what you do or don't have. It's all about what He has for you. This morning, none of us are full. None of us are complete. He's not through working on any of us. But He does have a full and a complete plan for each and every one of us. This morning, what He starts, He finishes. And I am sure of this, that He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. I want to let each and every one of you know, whether you're watching online or you're here in person, it's not by accident. It's not by accident that you're here. It's not by accident that you clicked on our Facebook page and you're watching this message online. It's not by accident. God has a plan and He has a purpose for you. And He loves you. This morning, you want a fresh start, or you want to begin that relationship. You've never had it. Our prayer team is here. They're available. They're here to pray with you, to strengthen and encourage you, and to walk through all of that with you, answer any questions that you may have. This morning, maybe you find yourself stuck, yearning for that breakthrough, desiring for God to break in and break through, and you feel like you're spinning your wheels this morning. I want to encourage you, the God of breakthroughs is here. He's here. And he wants to and he desires to help you break out of the rut that you may find yourself in. Maybe you're here this morning and you've walked away from him. You've lost faith in him. You don't feel like he loves you. He still has a plan for you. He still loves you. You can never outrun that love. You can never do anything enough. You can never do wrong enough that he won't love you. It's an unconditional love. You find yourself in one of these places, in one of these areas, and you want somebody to pray with you. You want to begin a relationship. You want to break out of the rut. You want to restart the relationship. A prayer team is here to pray with you. Because what God starts, he finishes. What God starts, he finishes. So I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray, and while I'm praying, if you find yourself, maybe it's not in one of the areas that I mentioned this morning. Don't box it in this morning. But you find yourself, and God is pulling on your heartstrings this morning. He's knocking at your door, and he's asking to come in. He's asking to do a healing work in your life and in your heart this morning. And you need strength, and you need encouragement. I'd encourage you. Come, allow one of our prayer team members to pray with you. God, I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Father. God, that you stand at the door and you knock. All we have to do is open it and you'll come in. And Father, the pain that we're in, the rut that we're stuck in, Father, the relationship that hasn't began or has been brought to an end when we walked away, God, if we open the door, you'll come in and all the pain you'll begin to mend. The rut that we're in, Father, you'll break us out of the rut. Father, the relationship that has been brought to an end by us or hasn't even started, God, you'll begin afresh and anew. And God, this morning, you're knocking. And Father, there's some of us this morning, we stand in doubt. We don't know, Father. We just don't know. Are you ever going to finish it? God, is it what you've started in me, is it ever going to be brought to completion? And Father, we need to hear your voice in the promise this morning. We need to hear your voice in the promise this morning. That what you started, you will bring to completion. What you started, you will bring to completion. So God, this morning, I pray for every person under the sound of my voice. Every person under the sound of my voice. God, this morning I pray, Father, that we would not be too prideful. Or that we wouldn't be living in shame or guilt, because that's a ploy of all of those are ploys of the enemy, Father, to keep us from surrendering to what you have for us. And Father, I pray, Lord, that we would see this prayer team not as people that will judge us, but as people that will strengthen us and encourage us and will go to fight. They will go to battle with us. They will lift us up in prayer. They will strengthen us. They will encourage us, Father. They will grab us and hug us. And Father, they will hold our hands up. And Father, they will battle with us. So God, help us this morning not to be too prideful. Not to be too prideful to cry out in prayer. Not to be too prideful, Father, to run back to your arms. You stand with your arms open wide for us this morning. You stand with your arms open wide, welcoming us and beckoning us to run to you. So God, this morning, you know the situation. You, Father, you see each and every circumstance that is here this morning. You know the position of every person's heart. You know the position, where they stand with you. So, God, this morning I pray, Father, that you would do what only you can do. Father, I may not be able to see it, and I may not know it. But, God, even I stand in need this morning of a completing work from you in my heart and in my life. So this morning, God, I pray, Father, for those who have lost hope, for those who have lost hope, that you would renew the hope within their heart and life. For those, God, who the joy has left them, Father, that you would reinvigorate them, Father, with the joy of salvation, with your joy, with the joy that flows straight from your throne. Father, I pray for each and every person under the sound of my voice, because you died for each and every one of us, but you also rose again for each and every one of us. Father, you died for our sins, but you rose again, Father, so that we can stand with you in victory for all of eternity. So God, this morning I worship you. I thank you. I magnify you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. This morning we're about to enter into communion. But I don't want to move too fast. I don't want to move too fast. Still with every head bowed, every eye closed. Communion, I want to read it. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting in verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." But this is the part and why I want to take time this morning. "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord is unworthy, in an unworthy manner, will be guilty concerning the blood, the body, and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you have come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment about these things. I will give directions when I come." What Paul is saying to us there is that we need, each and every one of us need to examine our hearts. And if we know there's sin in our hearts, then we need to repent of it. And we're about to partake of communion. But I want to take time, and I want each and every one of us this morning, you've heard the promise and you felt the presence of the Lord, and I know that God's been knocking on someone's heart's door this morning. He's letting you know that he loves you and that he died for your sins, and you don't have to live under condemnation and under guilt and in shame anymore. He's made a way. He's made a way. And he wants to fulfill the plan for your life. He wants to fulfill it in your life. But we have to examine ourselves this morning. If there's any sin in us, we need to repent of it.
allow him to cleanse us. God, Father, I take this time right now for us to examine ourselves. Father, to give more time for the person or the persons this morning, Father, that you are beckoning to. That you were letting them know, Father, that you love them, that you care for them, that you died for them, for their sins, to give them a way out of the hopeless situation. To restore to them the joy and the hope. So, Father, this morning, I pray each and every one of us would take the next few moments, that we would examine ourselves, and we would repent of anything that may be wrong, that we would repent of anything that may be wrong. Men that I've talked to, if you would come, make yourselves available. Prayer team, thank you. Scott, go ahead, you're fine. Yeah, you're fine. Yeah. Amen, these men are going to pass out. Go ahead. And as they pass these out, go ahead, Leisha.
Commands my destiny. No till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Can you worship him this morning, church? God, you're so worthy. God, you're so worthy. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Charles, lead us in prayer over the bread, please. Mighty God. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we thank you for this body you've given.
Hallelujah.
Everything that happened to it was for us. We thank you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Let us partake together. Amen. Alan, would you lead us in prayer over the juice? Precious Jesus. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let us partake of the juice together. Thank you, Jesus. Can you worship him this morning? Can you worship him? Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Sing Thank there you, in the ground.
God, we worship you. Father, you are so worthy. God, you're so worthy. We magnify you. We lift you up. The grave could not hold you. Death is not a part of you. Father, you are worthy. We magnify you and we worship you. You stand in victory. And because we are your children, Father, we stand in victory this morning. We stand in victory. Father, there's nothing that the devil can do. There's nothing that the enemy can throw at us, Father, that can defeat us as long as we stand with you and hold to your hand. God, I worship you, Father. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. You are worthy. You and you alone. You and you alone are worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Church, you are dismissed this morning. Go in the blessing and in the grace of God, knowing that you serve a risen Savior. Have a happy Easter this morning.